Hey Nick, how you doing?
Hi, Carla. I'm good. How are you?
Doing pretty good. Glad to be here.
Yeah, I'm glad you are here. Thank you so much for tuning in. Today, Francisco is going to knock out some live seller calls for us again.
Oh, that would be great.
Yeah, I love it when he does stuff like this. I'm always learning too. And then when clients call and ask things, I'm like, why don't you go back and watch this video? So Francisco was actually calling everybody. It's awesome. How's everyone's day going today while we wait for more people to jump in? Anyone have any questions they want to hit me with while they got me before we get started?
Oh, you guys are in early. Hey,
Hey, what's up, bro?
what's up, man?
I love the room you're in.
Yep, I'm in this co-working space.
Yeah, Francisco had a curveball begin right before this started, and some lawn guy cut his Wi-Fi cable. So
Yeah.
thank you, Francisco, for being dedicated to making this happen no matter what. Appreciate
No
you.
problem. No, by any means. Did you go over what we plan to do today, real quick?
I did mention that your goal was to knock out some live seller calls for everybody. And I think that's a good point too. If you guys have any leads that you've been wanting a call or struggling with, now's a chance to get some help from an expert. One thing we are thinking about doing together too, and we would be basing this off of your guys' interest, but I was thinking about offering as a service one-on-one live seller calls. So if you guys wanted Francisco to meet with you and call your leads for you and help you convert them, something that we were considering. One thing we were considering was doing it for like a flat fee plus maybe 10% of the deal or something. He will actually follow up, get it under contract, do stuff like that. And then if it doesn't work through, it's just the flat fee. But that way we're he's inspired to get on the phone and do his time, and then we can also provide a lot of help as well. I think one of the big lessons here isn't necessarily using him as an acquisition manager, but potentially using this time as a time to learn. What would I say when the time comes and it's not Francisco on the phone? One of the big things I took away from the last one was he has a bunch of really cool strategies when it comes to getting people down on price and talking about the competition, offering proof of funds. And I just really love some of the strategies. And so if you ever were to even use these calls or use this as a service, even just doing it one or two times sometimes might be all you need to give you the confidence to then take more control by yourself as well.
Agree. And just to touch on that real quick, and I was telling somebody this a couple weeks ago, one of the ways that I build confidence in regards to sales is picking three individuals that I study religiously, in their sales skills and their acquisitions, how they talk to sellers, and just really doing discovery-based selling as opposed to trying to pressure them or convince them to sell to me directly, right? It's more just so about taking the opportunity to educate the other person that you're on the phone with. And if they're receptive and they're open to actually having a conversation, and if they're realistic, you can, if you ask the right questions, you can get the necessary information to the position the conversation to align with your objectives and your goals. Not every seller is going to be reasonable. We're going to always deal with sellers that feel like their property, their land, their house is always going to be worth more than the next door neighbors. They're going to feel entitled, whatever the case may be. But you just also have to make sure that you again position the conversation in a way where, you're able to quickly discern, hey, is this someone that I could spend a little bit of time with? Is this someone that I need to follow up with? Or is this someone that I need to try to just do a little bit more probing to actually see what's gotten them to the point to considering to even sell, and see how I can, touch on that a little bit further. So I don't know if you guys have any questions, if you guys want to start off with questions about anything that you guys encounter talking to sellers or any common objections you guys often get, where it could be in land or houses, because it's pretty much the same.
I have a question. So I think that it's probably harder to have these calls with sellers when you're doing a double close. I mean, so for me, that's what I'm still doing primarily. I'm not purchasing outright. I'm double closing. So it's sometimes really hard for me to figure out how to frame it. So, so that I know, I mean, a lot of times I do cover the aspect that I'll be marketing the property, but I have found that that pushes people away a little bit. It distances them. So sometimes I don't talk about that aspect. And sometimes, honestly, people don't even care. But I think that doesn't that play into a little bit what you're talking about? Whether you're going to purchase it outright or if you're going to sign the contract and double close on it.
To be honest, like even if you're double closing, right? Because technically, if you really think about it, when you're double closing, technically you are purchasing it. You're just not using it your money. You're using
Right.
the buyer's, proceeds to satisfy your end of the transaction. So legally on paper with the seller, you could technically say that, right? One of the things that I've learned, and I accredit this particular form of understanding due to the fact that I went and got licensed. And when you go get your real estate license, they don't teach you how to sell real estate at all. They don't even talk about that. They talk a majority of the test is you memorizing the legal statutes and all like the legal jargon associated with being in real estate in general, right? It's almost like you're a poor man's lawyer. You learn about the law, but you can't practice the law, if that makes sense. And I think taking that opportunity to take the time out to study that has given me a different perspective on wholesaling, and two, it's the main reason why wholesaling was a lot easier for me to consume and digest because I studied so much for the real estate test, right? So when it comes to having conversations with sellers in the aspect of double closing or even outright assigning it, right? An assignment fee is basically a buyer paying you a commission. It just so happens that that's the title of it is named an assignment fee, or in a form, it comes in a form of an assignment fee. So one of the ways that you can phrase that in a conversation, whether you're doing a double close or an assignment, if you're doing a double close, you could just simply tell the seller, like, hey, the funds that we agreed upon, or at the agreed upon, the number that's on the contract, that is the number that you would get at the time of closing. Minus any escrow fees, if you negotiate all closing costs being paid, you can throw that in there and stuff like that.
Hey, Tony, how you doing?
So for the double close aspect, I will communicate with the seller, hey, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, the contract price that we agreed on, that is what you'll walk away with at the time of closing once everything is finalized, minus any escrow or title fees. And then you just keep it very concise like that.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I do. I, in fact, never even talk about what I'm coming out with. It never comes up, really.
And then, as far as an assignment fee, like I'm as far as with assignments, because sometimes I've had one seller question the assignment fee. And the only reason he questioned it was because he just so happened to be a real estate attorney. That's it. And when he asked me about it, I was very forthcoming and very, honest about what was going on. But here's how I worded it. He was like, who's this assignment fee getting paid to? And I'm like, this assignment fee is getting paid to myself. And what I told him was that the end buyer is actually just simply paying me for my services. So my commission doesn't come out of your proceeds. So you're still walking away with the same amount that we agreed to at the time that we signed the contract. And it just so happens that I procured a buyer without charging you for my services. And they were more than willing to pay me for the services that I brought to them. And then the deal got completed.
Oh, that's a good angle. Yeah.
And it was like, oh, okay, great, cool, no problem. And
Yeah.
then he was happy. And then I think one of the ways that you can overcome the objection of an assignment fee, if it does ever come up, is putting it into the perspective of the seller, of letting them know, like, hey, I'm providing a service for you that you do not have to pay for, and it's not costing you anything. Right? If I do not deliver on what I promise you, I do not get paid. My job is to find someone that I can work with, that I can partner with, that could be ready, willing, and able to buy this property from you at the agreed upon price that me and you agreed on. And then at the end of the day, they're going to pay me for my services for helping them harder to do.
Okay. So in a double close situation, you would stress that you are finding a buyer for them, that that is the service that you're providing.
In a double close situation, if it comes up, yes. But if
Okay.
it doesn't come up, I will keep it very concise and just let them know, like, hey, me and my funding partners would be able to deliver the agreed upon amount that's on the contract at the time of closing.
Okay.
And then that way, it's still in the boundaries of one, being truthful, being ethical. Because if you think about it, the legal jargon of double closing and assignments, double closings, like I mentioned earlier, it's just the buyer satisfying the first portion of the transaction with the funds, right? And then you get what's left over. And then an assignment fee is just simply someone paying to take advantage of your position in the contract. They're paying to trade places with you.
Right.
So in that form, as long as you understand how to explain it in a way where it's digestible to a seller, and it doesn't come, because you want to know one way where you could blow a deal. You could tell the seller the exact same thing in a different format, and they'll get a totally different understanding about it. Because an assignment, you could tell the seller, hey, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, we're going to agree to one price, and then I'm going to find someone to buy it from me for $30,000 more.
Yeah, I always feel like when you bring up the fact that you're going to be marketing the property, that's what they think. That's hard.
Which is why it's important to frame it in a way where it's digestible to them, but not in a way where they get the understanding or the impression that you're taking advantage of them or hitting them over their head, if that makes sense.
Or that they could get more money if they don't go with you and they just list it.
Right. And then it's really just all about framing. I think one of the best speakers that I've heard talk about this subject is Myron Golden and a couple of other people. But he talks about specifically in sales, you really want to focus the other person on framing the conversation so they could focus what's inside the frame and not what's outside the frame, right? Because there's many different avenues that conversations can go with sellers, but in order to stay, on topic and in line with our objectives, we do have to position the conversations and frame the conversations in a way where it not only aligns with the seller's interest, but it also allows us to benefit from partaking in the transaction.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. Anybody else have any crazy stories with any crazy sellers?
I don't, Francisco. I just want to ask you, you said there were a couple of people that addressed the topic that you just talked about. You said Myron Golden, and who were some of the others?
Let me look at my library. I actually have my Kindle library. One of the books that I'm currently in the process of reading is Fanatical Prospecting. I don't know if you guys ever heard of that. And spin selling. And the authors of both of those books talk a lot about positioning and also discovery-based selling as well too. Where's my Kindle library so I can get these authors' names?
So you say it's discovery-based selling, and what was the other one?
Spin selling. So spin selling is by Neil Rackham.
Okay.
And spin selling is specifically where he talks about discovery-based selling. And the acronym for SPIN, if I can have it pulled up here, is a situation, problem, implication, need, and payoff. And a quick synopsis of the book is it's pretty much about Neil Rackham. He did a study of over 35,000 sales calls by the top sales forces across the world. And he compiled all of his findings of those 35 case studies into a book. And he talks about, you know, what were the contributing factors to closing sales in many different industries. And one of the top reasons that they found was as long as the salesperson was doing it, was asking the questions and discovering more about the prospect, as opposed to telling the prospect about how great they are, the benefits of their product or service. As long as the salesperson was controlling the questioning, majority of the time the sale closed. And that's what the book talks about. And
And
then
the guy, yeah,
fanatical
Fanatical, who's that
prospecting.
author?
Say one oh.
Who's the author of Fanatical Prospecting?
Jeb Blunt. Let me reopen my Kindle. Jeb Blunt.
Okay.
JEB and then Blunt, or BLOUNT, or Blount. One of those. Hopefully, I'm pronouncing his name right.
Okay. Thank
Yeah.
you.
Yeah, those two books by far are definitely a good resource, in my opinion. And then like I mentioned before, when Nick was passing the baton, three people that I studied religiously as far as sales was Kevin Ward, Keith Everett, and Brian Cassellis. All of these three individuals come from different walks of life. Two of them, their primary audience is realtors, but anyone that's in the real estate industry can consume their content and take some good information from it. And then Keith Everett, he specifically, his audience is more like wholesalers and things of that nature. So I just studied those three individuals religiously, and then I just combined the best aspects of those individuals, and then I just started talking to sellers all the time. And I was telling someone yesterday, when I first started talking to sellers, when I first started working in real estate, my day job was to work for as an account rep for UPS. So my shift was really from 3 p.m. to 11 p.m. So the way I used to practice cold calling, it may sound crazy, but I used to practice cold calling by door knocking. And I told myself that if I could get through a couple of hours of door knocking and not feel any like jitters, nervousness, or feel weird about knocking on complete stranger's door and having a conversation, that I could get through a phone conversation without no problem. And then once I did that for like a couple months, it was easy for me to transition on the calls, way easier.
That's pretty unique. That's
Yeah.
pretty unique. I like the idea. So the
Yeah.
third one, whose last name is Cancellus. What's the first name?
Brian, Bryan. Yeah.
And it's Cancellus, Cancellus, something like that.
Let me actually pull it up on YouTube. See,
Oh,
it's,
he's on YouTube? Okay.
yeah, he's on YouTube. Let's see.
Now, is Keith and Kevin on YouTube as well?
Yeah, Kevin is definitely on YouTube. And Brian, let me just put his YouTube channel on though. He's based out of California. Brian is based out of California. I don't know where Kevin is from, but Keith is based out of Alabama. That's Brian's YouTube.
Now, I've heard of Keith Everett. I remember when he started a few years ago, he really. He's only been a short time, but he has really, his career in that in wholesale has just
What
skyrocketed. I
does it
remember.
take? And I think, and I was just telling somebody this yesterday, when I think it was Brian, specifically for Brian. If you guys do check him out on YouTube, I would watch his videos. One of the reasons that I gravitated to Brian at the time was if you watch any of his videos that are probably from 4 to 6 years ago, he was actually documenting his like real estate journey in real time. Like it wasn't all the whole fluff, like, look at me, I closed hundreds and thousands of deals. He was like starting out during like 4 or 5 years ago. So all of his content from like from anywhere between 4 and 6 years ago, it's just so raw, authentic. You could tell like he wasn't over exaggerating his success. He was very open with like the progress that he was trying to make and also the journey that he was on. So that's one of the main reasons that I gravitated to Brian as well too. And he was very also like very on point, very concise every time I watched his video. So that's one of the main reasons. Anybody else have any other questions or sellers that they're working with that they need help with?
Yeah, I have a question. I just joined lead mining here a couple weeks
Sweet.
back, and we've got some good leads in, but we're running into issues with the leads being part of an HOA and the HOA not allowing short-term rental or Airbnb. And I mean, they say they're open to a conversation about it, but we haven't got any to budge on allowing that. So do you have any ways to kind of describe to an HOA of how, you know, they're still going to make their HOA monthly payment and whatnot, and allow us to go ahead and go forth with a short term or an Airbnb or something along those lines?
One of the things that I will ask them, do you know what market is this in?
What market?
Yeah, what market is this?
It's in Kansas.
Oh, in Kansas. Okay. I'm not too familiar with the landscape in Kansas, but one of the angles that I would try to maybe approach instead of letting them know like, hey, we're gonna have short-term rentals, I would ask them if they will allow corporate leasing. And the verbiage that I would use or the front that I would use is basically saying like, hey, oftentimes I have subcontractors or employees come in for 1, 2 weeks at a time, maybe sometimes even months at a time, and I need to be able to provide them housing. Would you guys be open to, having this turn into a corporate leasing so we can house our employees? And then just see what they say.
Okay, yeah, I didn't think about that. I like that because the leads that I'm referring to, they're in very, very nice areas. They're brand new houses. And one of them, I believe he was a doctor, and he moved in this house, and then he ended up and just moved somewhere else, and he just
Right.
can't.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, and I think the main reason, and all HOAs are different. My HOA, Jesus Christ, pain in the butt sometimes. But all HOAs are different. Their main concern is probably just making sure like people don't come in and party or disturb or be loud and things of that nature. So yeah, I would just use the jargon corporate leasing, like, hey, you need housing for your employees that come in and travel from all over. And they should have no reason to say, I can't think of any reason why they wouldn't, be open to that at least. So I would recommend that and see if it works out.
All right, thank you.
No problem. Chris, go ahead.
Yeah, what's going on,
On.
man? So have you ever, what would you say your largest land deal acreage wise you've been a part of is?
Not anything massive. Most of it has just been in the infill space and in houses. When I used to do houses, I will say that the biggest deal that I did come across really just came from a referral. I didn't do anything crazy. This referral came from a lady that I was dealing with who she had a really unique situation. And even though this wasn't like this referral, the lady that referred me to the biggest transaction I got, that particular person, the deal wasn't massive because she was in a unique situation, but it paid off because she referred me to her friend, which ended up being a massive deal. So yeah, it's everything that I've done has always just been in the infield space. I haven't really dabbled too much in like larger tracts of land or big acreage. But that is on my agenda to tackle by the end of this year, going into 2025, and to be more experimental with attacking that area of land flipping.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so the reason I was asking is because I was wondering if you had any experience with, I guess, like larger tracts that are that have potential for development, and being a part of the like entitlement process. And, you know, like kind of having your dispoing that, you know, to like home builders or developers as end buyers.
Yeah.
Kind of like the entitlement process being your value, more of a value add part. So do you have any experience with that?
Nah, so if I ever come across those situations, or even when I have in the past, I've always reached out to individuals in my network that are experienced that could guide me down the path of like, okay, what do I do with this? And when it comes to having a conversation, just because you don't necessarily know, and this is kind of like my philosophy, just because I don't know something, I'm not going to, one, pretend like I do know what I'm talking about. I'm going to be very forthcoming and let the seller know, like, hey, I'm going to let the seller know, like, hey, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, this is currently out of the realm, out of my expertise. So I will have to bring someone in to, you know, to guide me along. And I will have to partner with someone that has a lot more experience in this particular, you know, field, or, you know, in this particular type of transaction. But I do want to assure you that I want to make sure that I bring someone in that can get us across the finish line. And as long as you're okay with me bringing in some resources and, you know, partnering with people, I would love for us to work together. And then the question that I would frame, the question that I would use to kind of anchor or frame, or to gauge their willingness to move forward, is after I say all that, I'll ask the seller, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, does that sound good to you?
Mm-hmm.
And then just wait for them to respond.
Okay, yeah, I like the way you frame that.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
You really want sellers to, you really want to reassure the insecurities of talking to a complete stranger, especially when you're dealing with a massive project. And then with me, I would highlight the common challenges that most people would face dealing with big tracts of land, because the reality of the situation is if they had the money to make the improvements, they probably would have done it already so they could sell it for more. And then also educate them that it isn't an overnight process either. Where it's just like, especially if you're talking about, let's just say, for example, how many acres are you talking about?
Well, the last deal that I did was, I missed out on a lot more money on the last deal that I closed, but it was like 136 acres, and I assigned it to a buyer, but if I would have went more of the route that I'm kind of talking about, there would have been a whole lot more value and a whole lot more payout on the back end.
What ended up happening that like caused it to be less than you expected, if you don't mind me asking?
It was just, you know, like my own experience and my just kind of eagerness to like get the deal across the table. Plus, I sold it to a friend, you know, who was looking for, it was exactly what he was looking for. So I was like, hey, I've got, you know, it was like everybody, it was like a win-win-win all the way across. But
gotcha.
Yeah, so that was mainly what it was. Yeah. But like, when I come across something else like that, I would like to be a bit more,
like take your time to see if you can maximize it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And actually sort of, you know, work with, you know, other potential buyers other than just selling deals to my friends, you know?
Yeah. I'm currently dealing with something like that now, where it's just kind of, it's almost like you gotta choose your gambles safely, I would say, right?
Yeah.
There's always the opportunity and upside to like shoot for more. But I would rather have some, I would have rather have the green plus sign in my account other than zero. None.
Obviously, at the time it was like, it was my first deal. So it's like, oh, I just want to get this across the table as soon as possible. I've already got a buyer. I'm going to just assign this thing over, which is cool. Yeah.
And I will say, though, like there, if there's one deal I had to do over, it's probably this one, my first probate deal that I ever done. And I know for a fact I left money on the table. In hindsight, it was probably, you know, a good thing. But it's also one of those things where, you know, it's like a, it, you need it to be a learning experience. So, you know, not to necessarily just jump at the first offer that you get just for security's sake. Right.
Yeah.
Because basically it was a probate deal. I called the seller, or I texted the seller. He called me back and he stayed in Georgia. The property was down here in Clearwater. And basically he inherited the property from his father. And he was, he would have taken $20,000 for the property. That's how he was like. And I made the mistake of giving the first number and I offered him $150,000. And he was like, okay, no resistance, no nothing. The house next door at the time was listed for $450,000. And then it had to go through probate. The probate was a whole thing. So the long story short, the probate ended up lasting a year. Closer to the time when the probate was about to end, and this was back in 2021, a year later, houses in the area were selling for like $800,000, $900,000. And what I should have done was just took the project down myself instead of just wholesaling it for $50,000. And I would have made way more money than just wholesaling it. But yeah, I think we all have to have that one that we wish, like, man, that should have been I need to do over on that. But that did teach me to have a little bit more patience in analyzing all potential exit strategies. And also understanding, okay, the risk involved with each one. Cause at the time I was like, the philosophy that I had was it's better to dance with a devil that I know rather than dance with a devil I don't know. And at the time, I really had a good relationship with the buyer that I was selling it to. And I was like, one, I know I could, if I did still go down the path of wholesaling it, I knew I could have sold it for more to another buyer. But then I run the risk of, doing a deal with someone that I don't know. They screw me over. It doesn't go through the finish line, whatever the case may be. So I was like, man, I know this guy. I already closed a couple of transactions with him. Let me just stick and play it safe. And then even during while the probate was ending, in my mind, I knew, man, I could really make more money doing something else. But then there's a risk associated with the unknown, especially that would have been my first like rehab project or whatever the case may be. So there was just kind of a lot, but in hindsight, I would have just taken time to analyze. If I didn't feel 100% confident in doing it myself, I would definitely align myself with someone that can walk me through the finish line and guide me to take full advantage of it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure. I didn't even utilize my buyer's list, or like I didn't use any of my due diligence period to look at other potential like exits. I just like straight up assigned it to this guy.
Wow, gotcha. And he was okay with you assigning it to him, right? He didn't care what you was making or whatever.
No.
Oh, okay, yeah. I mean, shit, it was a win-win then.
Yeah. The whole transaction was transparent, but
yeah,
could have made about $50,000 more if I had with the same buyer. I could have double closed it, or I also let the buyer just kind of beat me up on price because he was a whole lot more experienced. It was kind of like teaching me a lesson. I mean, this guy, we go way back. It's like a
yeah.
So he was just like, he told me what he would have paid for it after it closed, and I was like, it was like a $50,000 difference. I was like, wow, okay.
Hey, don't let him get you again. Yeah.
It was fun, though.
No, that happens. But, I mean, that was your first one, though, right?
Mm, yeah.
Nice. Congratulations.
I've got another seller right now who's asking for 90K I think it's like two, I guess it's 2 acres, or maybe it's an acre. He wants market value for it. But I mean, if I subdivided it to half an acre, I mean, half an acre is in that area going for like 60K. And I think there's like residential houses that are being developed over there where they're going exiting at like around 400. So I'm wondering if I were to subdivide it and kind of figure out, do the math on what the potential profit would be for someone who was willing to come in and build two residential properties there, to see if there's enough room to actually offer him somewhere near market value.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Well, you know, one interesting strategy that I'm like brainstorming right now. I know it will work in Florida. I do not know if it'll work in other markets because I do have to do some additional research. But one of the things that you can do, you might have to partner up with the realtor depending on, you know, whatever state that you're in and things of that nature. But one of the things that you could do for sellers that want to, what do you call it? Put it on market for market value is you can either, one, you can either, you're not going to make as much money as you would wholesaling it, but at least you could, it's like miscellaneous cash flow type of thing, is you could charge them for a flat fee listing and then, you know, either split it with a realtor or put it on a market as like a open net listing. In an open net listing, it allows, basically, it's a realtor's version of an assignment fee or wholesaling, basically, is what they refer to open net listings. And it pretty much indicates that the seller is going to walk away with X amount, and then the realtor's commission is going to be based on the difference of what he sells it for.
I didn't think that. So there's a form of net listing that's not illegal.
Yeah.
I know like some novations are sort of kind of, that's kind of like the idea of a novation contract, kind of getting net listing. But so this is different from a novation.
I'm not too I've always heard of the term novation. I don't know if this form, I don't know if this falls under novation. But it was something that, as I was, you know, doing some research, open net listings is perfectly legal. And then I could show you a sample document that I drafted and ran by three brokers. And they're like, yeah, as long as the seller agrees to it, there's nothing, you know, wrong with it.
Okay, so you're just talking about signing a purchase agreement with him, disclosing that you're going to partner with an agent, do a flat fee listing.
Mm-hmm.
He gets his purchase price and we split the rest.
Yep. And then let me zoom in. It's really under paragraph one. Let me see if I can make it bigger. Right here. It's okay. Seller understands the listing agent commission will be added to the sales price and paid by the buyer, ensuring no deduction from the seller's net proceeds. House Edge, which is the company that I have my license hanged under, will retain the difference between the sales price and the net proceeds as a commission.
So if I don't have an LLC, would the agent be able to, are you getting paid out of the agent's commission?
Well, in this particular case, this was one that I'm using in Florida, and I am licensed in Florida. But in this particular case, it will probably be more so of a joint venture agreement between you and the listing agent. If you do refer it out, be very careful not to say like referral fee or something like that. Just have like a joint venture agreement, and you can get paid a transaction fee, a consultation fee, like anything in real estate, as long as they're a contract for it, you can name fees whatever they want, whatever you want to.
Yeah, marketing fee or acquisition fee.
Marketing fee, acquisition fee. As long as it's in the contract, you give it to the title company, they'll add it in there, and then it's paid out by however you got structured in the contract.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So this guy doesn't want to work. He doesn't want to work with an agent. Doesn't want to list with an agent, but he wants near market value. He's got blueprints for a residential property.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, his reasoning behind not taking less than market value for the property is, you know, the fact that he could just go in there and, you know, develop it himself, even though it seems to be pretty clear that that's not his intent.
So he has blueprints, but he doesn't want to build on it.
Yeah. Yeah.
He wants market value. He wants market value, but he also doesn't want to list with a realtor.
Yeah, I mean, I've presented the, you know, like a soft offer around, you know, it seems like, you know, that you might be interested in developing yourself, and, you know, making the profit that way. But, you know, if I were to come in and do the development, you know, then I would obviously need, you know, more room on the purchase price. But
Do you open to that?
No, he's like hard on 90K.
I mean, he's kind of running out of, we're doing process of elimination. I mean,
I've literally ran through everything, and it's like the only thing that, like, this guy is like hard on 90K. So I'm just wondering if,
I mean, if you've done process of elimination with him already, and you've ran through 3-4 different variations of, you know, potential scenarios or offers that you can present to him, and you've declined it all, and he just wants 90K. I mean, it doesn't really sound like he's like motivated to, you know, unless someone just randomly knocks on his door and drops 90K and say, "Hey, I want this for 90K," then, you know. Yeah. But in my professional opinion, I would mark that as someone that's not necessarily motivated to make something work right now at this time, you know.
Yeah, well, I like your potential, like, avenue of, you know, like, maybe working with an agent, doing a flat fee listing, and, you know, potentially getting his 90K,
right?
Seeing what the potential is for.
Yeah, and then this is the way that I will word it for him exactly. I say, "Hey, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, listen, I understand that you want 90K. I want to be able to provide you a service that can get you that 90K without you having to pay, you know, any commissions. It will cost you something, but essentially this is the way that I want to frame it for you. You'll pay a $300 flat fee for us to list it, and then you'll field all the calls, and then we'll handle all the paperwork for you. We'll market it. We'll make sure that we post it nice and pretty, so that way your phone can blow up and a whole bunch of people can call you and see what the market is bearing at that price point. And if you want to handle all the calls, you can. If you want us to handle the calls for you and just present you the offers, we could work that out as well too. But in order to get your 90K, it will cost you the flat fee amount. Insert flat fee amount. And it will do all the work for you. We'll present all the ready, willing, and able buyers at your front doorstep. And then I think if you make it sweeter for them, just say, "Hey, we'll field all the calls for you and then present all the offers to you." So that way you don't have to, you know, we don't get anything outside of this flat fee, and then you keep the rest.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. Sweet. So let me know how it works out.
Yeah, appreciate it, man.
Awesome. Thank you. Dez, I believe you had your hand up or raised. I don't know if you still have a question.
Hey there.
Is that me?
I am a lot like Chris. One of the things that I have noticed with the whole large tract land, I'm actually going through right now, and it's that the sellers are a lot of times also the builders and developers as well. That's one of the situations I'm dealing with. I was calling just to make relationships with builders and developers, and had one who was trying to get out of a project to get into another project. And he just overspent on the project, right? It has entitlements, it has infrastructure, it has utilities ran, but he totally overspent. And so he's like trying to sell it. And the pushback that I'm having from a lot of other builders and developers is that, of course, they want to buy the land at 20% of their project. Mm-hmm. And it's been a difficulty for me to show them how much they're going to be saving in like hard costs and soft costs. Mm-hmm. To be able to add to the offer. Like, so basically like how you're saying the entitlements and things like that, yeah. Placing value on those for them to pay a premium above that 20% seems to be my issue.
So, but what did the seller overspend on if he like put money into it and there's not like, is there not enough value already added based on what he's already put into it?
He put almost $2 million in infrastructure. Like, it's 37 lots, so seven wow. acres, 37 lots, and he put almost $2 million in infrastructure. He, like, the streets are done, street signs are going up, utilities are ran, but it's been difficult to explain to people, like, you're not going to get this at 20%, you know, of your land cost. They're like, well, you know, we want to stay around here. And it's like, how do I get them to understand he needs to recoup that money that he spent in infrastructure, even though I know he kind of overspent in infrastructure.
Yeah.
You don't mind me asking, where is this deal?
This is in Missouri City, Texas.
Okay. Sounds like... So I know a guy who kind of mentors me who deals with situations like this for builders all the time. But there was an exact situation in my market recently where a developer kind of got himself in the same sort of bind where he seemed to overspend on the development and the project halted for a long time. And this guy I mentioned comes in and gets hired out for about $8,000 a month to coach them on how to get their project back up and running. He's like a real estate magician. So like now, after they hired him, over the past couple of months, I've seen like development restarting back, and they're about to put up like tons and tons of like upper 300 priced residential homes in the area. So this guy is like a specialist in like turning those kinds of development projects around.
And I think that's where it's either leaning towards the fact that he's just going to go ahead and keep developing. He knows he overspent a little in the infrastructure and he's just going to try to refinance the project and keep going. Right. Mm-hmm. Or he wants to still sell. So I guess I'm just trying to, and because I do still think that there's some value there. Yes, he did overspend the infrastructure, but I definitely think that there's still a good profit margin there for somebody to pick up that project. I guess I'm having a difficult time just explaining the value of like, okay, I understand that this is where you need that to be, but we need to take into account all the things that are there and that are done and then give that some value in the offer, where you can take that in other line items, you know, take that out of other line items and allocate it towards the offer part. So
I have a quick question just out of curiosity, because this by no means is this my realm of expertise, but I am curious to know, is there like a big discrepancy based of from what the buyer is willing to pay and based on what he wants? Is it like a huge gap?
Yeah. So at first, when I first got it, he wanted it at about 100K a lot.
And there's seven lots.
There's 37 lots.
Oh, 37 lots. Okay.
37 lots is 7 acres. And so he won them at 100K a lot.
Okay.
And most of, and I think he said he had gotten an offer from DR Horton at that, around that. And so, I don't know what happened with that, but I had a few bigger builders reach out to me about the project, but some were trying to offer like 75,000 a lot, 80,000 a lot. And that's a big difference. And so now I'm kind of getting him to see that if an offer does come in, it's going to be around between 87 and 90K a lot. Yeah. And in order for him to kind of recoup his costs and, you know, be able to be liquid, what he needs to be for the next project, he did need to kind of sell it around the 100K. So I get what he was trying to do, but he may just have to recoup and get a little.
I would say, to me, without, and this is just off of face value, it sounds like it's a finished product. It sounds like, you know, all they have to do is just start digging and building, right? It looks like all of the groundwork has already been done. So I do agree with you that the selling point should all be there. I understand that if I was in your situation, the way that I will word it is, hey, I definitely understand that you guys want 20% of, you know, the total project or your soft costs or whatever the case may be, but this is on a silver platter for you. If everything is lined up the way the seller is saying, you know, just itemize, like, this is how much it will cost you for this, this is how much it will cost you for that, and this is what you're totally, you know, this is what the numbers are, right? And then just do a side-by-side comparison based on what they will acquire for if they had to do everything themselves. And then this is the price that you're, you know, getting everything with everything already included, and you don't have to do any additional work. That's what I would do if I was in your position, or find someone that can help you make that a visual counter argument to we needed that 20%. Because that would be a lot more difficult to retort or, you know, come back. Because right now, I'm not saying they're playing semantics, but they're like, they're trying to get a deal. And the angle of, well, he overspent is not necessarily their problem. If anything, that's going to motivate them to drive their point even home even further. So I would say, whether it be with Chris, if you partner up with Chris and he gives you the connections, or anyone that could just, you know, help you visually put together a counter argument or even a presentation that can allow people to see the value, as opposed to trying to just explain it, you know, from real words.
Yeah, well, I honestly, as you were talking, that really, really helped me. Thank you so much, Francisco, because I did do a drone video of the property. And I think having that side-by-side comparison, showing why it is what it is, and then sending that out, I think that's going to be a game changer for understanding. So thank you, because I definitely see how that can work.
No problem. Yeah. And I will also say, look at, you know, what Chris is able to, you know, connect you with, if that's maybe an avenue that you, you know, want to explore, and it can maybe be beneficial for you guys.
Absolutely, Chris. If you don't mind, definitely send me your contact information.
Regina, I'll send you my contact info.
Is this Regina?
Yes, it is.
And then I'll connect with this guy and see if he'd be interested in something, in a project like that out in Texas.
Awesome. And actually, too, another thing was, I was able to convince the seller, if he wasn't, because this is his first development project, so he may have overspent somewhere, you know, that's the mistakes of being a new developer. But I did talk to him about being a little bit more reasonable and selling off some of the 37 lots. Like, he already has 3 of them pre-sold, and you know, like, having a pre-sold lot that is also permit ready to go vertical, I think would be also a good way to sell it off too. So maybe not get it all at one time. But
are you familiar with what Because I guess his goal was to build like residential.
A subdivision.
Okay. Are you familiar with like what each of those properties would sell for on the market, like a new construction?
For the architect plans that he has, it's they're at $399. However, that was the other thing I had to kind of talk to him about, was because Taylor Morrison just finished a subdivision catty corner to this, and they're at $350. So it was like, we got to be a little bit reasonable about what people are building in this area as well. Because it was also inside, the subdivision is inside of an older subdivision. I don't know if you guys have seen that, but in Texas, they're doing that a little bit. And so it doesn't have its own main entrance off of like the busy street. You go through an older subdivision and then you go into a gated new construction subdivision. Okay. So that was the only other thing as well.
That's kind of tight. I don't know. Those numbers sound kind of tight for him all across the board.
So I guess ideally it would be like, what, 37 houses at 350?
Ideally for him, it was 399 and up. And he was doing a little bit bigger builds. So I can't say that the square footage wasn't bigger than what was around there. But he's just doing the risk of it appraising for less, is what I'm saying.
Oh, so these are all specs then?
Yeah.
Well, let's just assume that it was 350. I mean, 350 a house times 37 is almost 13 million. Uh-huh. He's looking for what, 3.7, you said?
Well, we came to an agreement that it's going to be between like 87,000 and 90,000 a lot is what he's going to be willing to accept.
With all the groundwork and stuff done, it seems like for a developer to come there and build the home, it seems like there might be enough room there.
Yeah, I did just convince one builder of that not too long ago, and he's reconsidering his offer because originally he said he was at 76,000. And I got off the line and I like talked to him, and he was like, I'm willing to reconsider it. Just send me the proof. So right now I'm getting all the permitting and stuff. Documentation from CenterPoint, which is the utilities, just to confirm that it's vertical ready. And so he said he's willing to come up quite a bit on his offer once those things are confirmed. So we'll see.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. It's not done yet though. So right. I'm still cooking.
I do definitely got to commend you because you got some marketing going on the background that looks extremely fire. So Thank you. Shout out to you, your vision, our land. It says our expertise.
There you go.
And you got the QR code. You're doing the damn thing. I'm proud of you.
Thank you. You were in the beginning of this, Francisco. I appreciate you.
No problem. Terrence says, anyone with experience can help me analyze two deals that he has. Doesn't mind JVing after the Zoom. Terrence, what market are those deals in? Is he still on? I don't know if he's still on. But yeah, I will also encourage you guys, if you do have JV opportunities, this will be a perfect platform or medium to, you know, for us to network and also be very vocal about what you guys have going on, because you never know if someone may have the answer to a question or a situation that you're dealing with a seller that can help you get across the finish line. Even the conversation that Dez was having with Chris, I learned a little bit too. And stuff like that intrigues me. So one of the things that I will leave you guys with is also do not let the curiosity of learning stop you from, you know, executing certain things. Because Dez, I don't know if you had previous experience with those larger tracts of land, but I do briefly remember when we first met that it was like an avenue you wanted to explore, and it sounds like you've definitely been exploring it. So
I didn't do it on purpose. I'll say that.
right.
Yeah, I definitely didn't do it on purpose. I was in development first, and then learning the land part, it was how I'm gaining my experience in development. You know, like you're not considered a real developer until 8 to 10 experiences. And so instead of kind of, I wanted to make sure that I was bringing value to development deals, and land is a huge part of that. So, and I used to, I was, my, but my background for 10 years is in underwriting and processing investor packages for a commercial real estate lender. So that's how I understand like the back end stuff. And then it's all, it ends up being all being the same. Like we think it's different because it's like smaller numbers, but it really all ends up being the same amount of work and the same type of process. So I had to just get over being scared of it.
Agreed, 100%.
Yeah.
And Reagan said, "Can Chris and Des have a class elaborating on larger tracks?" Man, Reagan, we went on like a I think a 3-4 week run of having back-to-back guests that were like experts on big tracts of land. And we want to bring more people too. But yes, to answer your question, 100%, yes. If Dez and Chris feel comfortable leading a call, we're more than happy to have some expertise to be shared.
I mean, I'm definitely no expert in the area. I mean, I'm still learning too, but I mean, I'm kind of edging on joining a mentorship in this space of larger developmental like potentially development tracks where, you know, they teach you how to execute the entitlement process without actually having like excavating any of the dirt or anything like that. You're basically just kind of handing developers
Facts.
like go ready
Yeah.
development tracks, you know. So I mean, yeah, the more I dig into that, the more I'll definitely be in this chat and sharing that information for sure.
And you know what? And this is also going to be kind of like a open-ended invitation if you guys are open to it, because I'm definitely down. Like I said, getting into bigger tracts of land is something that I do want to experiment with and also learn, right, in real time. So if we can create an environment where we're all learning, the exact same thing or the form of the exact same thing in real time, I think that would be super beneficial for not only myself but for everyone involved. So that way you guys can see like, okay, what it's really like, because I can't see it any different than the infield stuff. I know there's nuances and more specifics, but kind of to Des's point, it's still connecting A to B. And then we just have to figure out the in-between, the lingo, the jargon, what to look out for, obviously. But yeah, just creating an atmosphere where it's not only just one person, giving out information or saying, look at me and stuff like that, because we're all learning in different facets anyway. So I think that would be a great experience to kind of say like, hey guys, I got this 15 acre. I don't know what I'm doing. Anybody want to help me out?
Yeah.
And be comfortable sharing that as well too. So like I said, if you got a seller or a situation that you're dealing with, somebody in this group might be able to help, right? You might be working on one side of
Definitely,
the business.
definitely not the expert,
Right.
but I have learned that real estate, a lot of real estate is connected. So I definitely, and like as it's said in the Diary of a CEO, I don't know if you guys have ever read that, but the best way to perfect your craft is to teach it. And so I am so down for teaching and just sharpening tools and learning more. I definitely got to give it to Darby and Francisco because they taught me a lot of this land portion. And my background and skill set really helped me bridge what was going on in a different way. So just connecting with that and then leaning on the community. I'm part of the land community with Darby. with Lead Mining Pro and then with women in real estate as well. So just having those connections to talk to all different parts of the industry is, I think, very helpful. So I would love to be a part of that in any way possible.
Sweet. Awesome. Well, thank you guys. For those of you guys who stayed on, I know we went a little bit over than usual, but I really enjoyed today's call. Today was great. I wish Nick was still on, but it's okay. I will be out next week, guys. I will be out next week. So Nick will be holding it down. Next week is my birthday. Your boy is turning 28. So I will be MIA for next week. But I will be back the following week after I recover from my birthday activities. So it was a very good class. Thank you guys for, spending some time with us. And I personally will see you in 2 weeks. But Nick will hold it down next week for you guys, okay? Awesome.
Thank you.